Hello everyone, welcome to our presentation on Cyber, Fast Scalable Data Engineering. My name is Supun Kambulgamle and I'm with my teammate Miranda Pereira. Cyber is a new growing project we started at the end of the last year, and we are looking to further grow our community. Apache is one of the best places we know to build a community around the project. So we are super excited to give this presentation here in ApacheCon. First, let me introduce myself and my colleague. I'm an Apache Foundation member and I'm working as a principal software engineer leading Cyber project at Indiana University. Miranda is doing a PhD at Indiana University and is a founding member of the Cyber project. So first I'll go through the introductory part of the presentation, and Miranda will go through the architecture of Cyber and small demonstration. So data science workflows. Data science workflow is a complex iterative process. It starts with data in large data stores. These can be raw data or set process data. So from these data, we create structured data sets for using ETL tools such as Hadoop or Spark. The structured data are stored in databases or files. For our data science applications, we use these structured data. Once we have the data in structured storages, we can start creating hypotheses around this data. The structured data is queried and transformed to fit into the inputs of the machine learning or deep learning algorithms. So after that, we train our models, we look at our outputs, we visualize things, and we do this iteratively until we get a good model. So this is a complex process that involves many different tools, languages, different hardware platforms, data storages, and visualization tools. The actual machine learning, deep learning part may be very small compared to the overall data engineering environment surrounding this process. So this picture shows exactly that point, and it is taken from the paper Hidden Technical Debt in Machine Learning Systems by Google. I think it correctly identifies the complex nature of the data science workflows and the rich software stack around the machine learning core to make everything work. So the tools available to make this work comes from two separate ecosystems. On one side, there are enterprise data management and data processing tools around the Java language. On the other side, there are machine learning, deep learning, visualization, statistics, frameworks around the Python language. Observation that we have is we rarely see researchers use Flink, Spark, or Hadoop for doing serious work at the research application level. On the other hand, Python and deep learning frameworks are thriving in high-performance clusters inside national labs and universities. This is because these Python frameworks are using high-performance C++ code underneath the user-friendly APIs provided by these languages. To become part of the machine learning, deep learning world, big data frameworks provide Python APIs, but Java and Python are not not natively compatible. So these integration need to jump through hoops such as spawning Python processes and Java processes separately and establish communication between them to run them together. On the other hand, Python and C++ natively integrate together with minimal performance overheads, and C++ and Java also natively integrates with the JN90s. So to support these different storage and frameworks and applications, modern data science clusters have a mixture of GPUs, CPUs, different storage capabilities, and sometimes special hardware. For example, most supercomputers deployed in the national labs and universities now have GPUs to facilitate deploying workloads, and they are equipped with faster networks as well. And looking at some of the hardware trends, like we see more and more CPU cores added each year to a single chip, increasing the parallel performance. Now 64 core CPUs are available with 128 threads. We see increasingly more memory in machines, and 256 gigabyte or 512 gigabyte machines are not uncommon. Technologies like Intel Optane are further increasing the available memory for applications. Today, the standard, and also like today, the standard network speed for new clusters around 25 gigabytes per second or 40 gigabytes per second, compared to 1 gigabyte per second about 15 years ago. Those speeds have increased significantly, and costs have come down significantly as well. And also it is becoming cheaper and cheaper to use fast storage systems such as NVMEs compared to mechanical hard disks. Most machine learning, deep learning workloads obviously run on GPUs and special hardware devices. So I think with all these hardware trends and special hardware, so I think in order to get the full advantage of them, we can no longer rely on the Java language, at least for the critical parts of these frameworks. So if I am implementing a data science workload today, I would like an environment where I can work productively while keeping flexibility without compromising the performance. Productivity is, of course, a subjective matter. So some may say like a native C program, C framework is much more efficient than a Python framework. So, but among data scientists, languages such as Python and R are extremely popular because of their ease of use. I would like to use, so for my data science workflow, I would like to use different systems such as data processing systems, machine learning systems, deep learning systems, visualization systems in an integrated environment where there's less friction. So I can integrate these things without compromising the performance. I want to do all this while taking full advantage of the hardware available. So I don't think a single system will be able to meet all these demands. And I think we have passed the Java era for these systems, and it is time to implement like critical system components in a way that utilizes the hardware fully using system level languages such as C++. I think we are seeing this throughout the big data or data processing space. So a better approach is like, so as we know, like if we, as we know, 100% system languages are also not go well with users. So users need business friendly and user friendly languages such as Java and Python. So a better approach would be to implement critical parts of these systems as highly optimized libraries with system level languages, and use these libraries as accelerate to other systems. So what are the critical areas in distributed data processing? So compact data storage in memory, along with optimized distributed data operations, are key areas to accelerate data engineering. Because then it can utilize the caches and memory efficiently, CPUs efficiently, like that. And also, like, we can further enhance the network communications as part of the distributed operations using available network hardware. There are a lot of different network hardware available that perform at different speed within different features. So there are two widely used table structures in data processing tools. Tables are used for storing heterogeneous data. Second, there are numerical data. Numerical data is stored in tensors, matrices, and vectors. So these are mostly homogeneous data structures compared to tables. So you can use a table to store strings, integers, doubles. Like that, but you may use a tensor or tensor to store a homogeneous numerical data type. So tables are important for data processing applications, while machine learning, deep learning applications use these vectors, matrices, and tensors. So both these data structures you can store as a row major or column major format in memory. They specify how, whether you are storing a single column or a single row contiguous in memory. And the way we store the data has significant effect on the performance because of that access patterns and the cache. So because we are in the data processing space, not in the machine learning or deep learning space, we are mostly interested in table structures. So data engineering APIs. So you can build data engineering APIs around these table structures. So there are two types of distributed APIs for data engineering that are widely used today. First is the data flow APIs, which are popular in big data frameworks. I think all the big data frameworks support these APIs. They specify a computation as a graph, and parts of the graph can use the external storage to perform computations that don't fit into the memory. Because of this, the data cannot be given to the user as the complete set because they don't fit in the memory. So what these frameworks they do is they divide the data into small parts. It can be a record or batch of records, and then stream through the data flow APIs. And then the second type is the in-memory APIs, where you can store the complete data set in the memory. And these APIs expose the data to the user because they are kept as a whole thing in the memory. And also it is important to note that like most data science problems can be fit into the available memory of a cluster. So as I said earlier, both these tables can be used as underlying structures to build both these APIs. So Cylon is a fast, scalable, distributed table providing few fundamental relational algebra operations implemented in an optimized way. We use a table abstraction to represent the data in memory. The core operations along with the data structures all happen in C++ code. And we provide thin wrappers in Java and Python to run operation. So the in-memory table is kept using the Apache Arrow format. In fact, we use the Arrow code to manipulate the in-memory table. The code is Apache license version 2, and it is available in GitHub. So this picture shows our vision for accelerating data processing using the Silent library. So it is not a silent-centric view in the sense that we are at the center of everything. It shows that we can use a small accelerated library like Silent to speed up the data operations both in Python space and in JavaScript. So these are some pictures I took from Apache Arrow. So Apache Arrow is because we are using the Apache Arrow to represent the data inside Silo. Apache Arrow is a columnar in-memory data specification for storing the data, storing table data. It is a perfect format for what we are trying to do with Silo because it is supported by many frameworks and makes the integration super easy. So we are using the Arrow format internally to represent the data, and we can directly use the Arrow structures internally used to integrate with other systems that support that format. So I hand it over to Nilanda to continue to discuss with Alan and the rest of the presentation.
All right, thank you, Supun. So let me first share my screen. Okay, so let me first go through the architecture. So Silent actually follows a layered architecture, and the topmost layer of Silent has the language bindings, and it is backed by a C++ cross-language interface, and that will give access to all the data loaders. Currently, we support CSV and Arrow format data loaders, and below this layer, we would have the relational algebra operations, aggregations, and group by operations. And I will discuss more later on about the operations we have. And as for the network operations, we are mainly using MPI distributed mode at the moment, and we are in the process of using UCX as the communication layer as well. So this layered architecture allows Silent to add and remove things in a very convenient manner. Let's look at the main data abstraction of Silent, which is actually a table like Supun mentioned earlier. And these tables are partitioned horizontally across the parallel processors so that the parallel processors would work on its own partition and then communicate with the others where necessary. So this is synonymous to the bulk synchronous parallel paradigm, which Supun just mentioned a couple of minutes back. And we are also working on a more modular data flow inspired execution as well, which will be released very soon. As of now, these are the main distributed operations supported by Silent, and some more are in work in progress to provide a more robust and a complete data frame-like experience, mainly to the Python users. And this has been supported using Modin, and these operations alongside with those data frame operations, we are planning to give a more robust data distributed data frame abstraction. If you look at a typical application flow of Silent, it follows the extract, transform, and load approach. And if you take an example of a distributed join, we would first read the corresponding tables at each worker, and that will be wrapped around a Cylon table. And then we would describe a transformation logic. And if you take joins for an example, a join would start off by hash partitioning the table based on the index, and then shuffling the partitions, and then performing the local operation on it. So the output would either could be saved as another saved to disk in CSV format or in arrow formats, or else we could use it as an input to another table as well. The transform operations may also change. The order of these would change depending on whether it's doing a group by or an aggregation, or so on and so forth. So let's look at some performance highlights. We've been able to achieve approximately 50 billion records, joining 50 billion records in around 50 seconds. And this was done within 480 cores in a 10-node cluster with 100 Gbps Omnipath. And we believe that this performance is significant, and we are working on improving these numbers further as well. And in our last published paper themed High Performance Data Engineering Everywhere, we published our last published timings of 320 million records within just 2.3 seconds, which was eight times faster than Apache Spark and 30 times faster than Dask. And the scalability of Cylon was much better than these frameworks as well. And Cylon is actually all about integration. So we would like to have the ability to switch between runtimes, be that Python, Java, and C++. So we measured the timings between these runtimes, and we actually see very minimum or no significant difference between the language runtimes. So this supports the decision of us using a C++ backend that greatly reduces the overheads between switching between the multiple language interfaces. So if one might wonder how you could use Cylon, and like Supun mentioned, Cylon can be used as a standalone framework, very much similar to writing an MPI job, or it could be imported as a library for another framework. So ultimately, Cylon can be used as a library to improve performance of any data processing application. That is our end goal. And hence, we come back again to our Data Engineering Everywhere Ferris wheel, where Cylon is at the center of data processing and deep learning domains. And it could potentially accelerate data processing frameworks, as well as it can certainly integrate seamlessly with the current existing deep learning frameworks. So let's look at some hands-on demonstration on Cylon. And the source code for this demonstration is available in the Cylon GitHub repository under CPP source tutorial. And we are using, the repository checked out into a node that runs Jupyter Notebooks here. Let's look at the instructions readme. So we are using a data set, a simple data set from an article called Merge and Join Data Frames in Pandas. And this article refers to real data from Killer Bee application. So it's a set of CSV data here. And I would first go through the CPP code that will give you like the typical flow of a Cylon application. Cylon application usually starts off with the Cylon context being initialized. So we start off with rank. The Cylon context gives access to the information like rank, world, information like that, as well as cluster-wide operations such as barriers, etc. So in this example, we typically, in Cylon operations, we start off with a shared pointer to a Cylon table, and every Cylon operation would output a status indicating whether the operation was successful or not. So we'd be reading to CSV files and perform a distributed join operation. And in the distributed mode, each and every worker would read its own file from the data directory and then do a shuffled distributed join. And we'll be performing an inner join on indices 0 and 3. And we'll look at the number of rows in the input and the output. So to build the project, build this example, we can, since this is included in the Cylon CMake, parent CMake file, you can build it with the Cylon build script by passing the CPP flag. I have already built it in this system, so I'll just simply run the single threaded executable. So as you can see here, the first table had 272 rows, the second has 240, and the inner joined outcome has 159 rows. And if I extend this into the distributed operation, I could simply use MPI run and the number of processes. I'll pick 4 for the moment, and then I can simply use the same executable. But since I'm using in this particular node that has InfiniBand available, so I would have to pass some more parameters to it. So with this, you can see the 4 MPI workers are reading their own tables, and then does a shuffle in the middle, and then at the end of the distributed join operation, each and every worker would have their partitions for the join table. So the same example, an identical example of the same logic is available for Python. It's almost the same. How we write the program is almost the same. The execution needs a little more things, such as you need to create a virtual environment, as well as you need to pass the dash dash Python flag to build to the build script, as well as you'll have to fix export the Cylon and the Arrow libraries in using the LD library path. Execution is almost the same. Moving back to now, let's look at a small demonstration about how to use PyTorch in the Cylon environment, where Cylon would use MPI to manage the Cylon workers and pass on the work to PyTorch's workers, which are managed by NCCL, and we'll use a distributed data parallel input. So what would essentially happen is the Cylon table would be converted into NumPy and then to a tensor, which would be sent to the device. In this Cylon table to NumPy conversion, we try our best to do a zero copy data transfer to a tensor so that there will be minimum copies between these data transfers. So let me just walk you through the same example. It's called Demo PyTorch Distributed of Py. If I walk through the code, it's again like previously. You start off by creating a silent context for MPI processes. And the crux of the code would be, like the previous example, we'll be reading 2 files. The Python MPI processes would read 2 files and then perform a join operation on those. And to feed this into the distributed data parallel network, we'll be using the to numpy method here. That will create an ND array, and then use that ND array to create the PyTorch tensors, and then run this simple network. This is a 2-layer neural network, fully connected. And we would run it for 20 epochs. Let's see how that runs. The execution would be more almost the same. It's just that we would have to pass the environment Python runtime and so we'll be simply loading the tables. And then there's a join, and then everybody would be doing their own epochs. So the training of the dummy model is done. So that's like a very simple demonstration of how you could use Cylon in environment in frameworks like PyTorch. So coming back to the presentation, our roadmap for the immediate next would be to create a data flow like execution, and that will improve the performance and give NUMA and cache aware optimizations, as well as we are accelerating Twister to one of our sister frameworks using Cylon as a library. Twister 2, just to mention, is an officially recognized Beam runner at the moment. Also, like I mentioned, we are working on a distributed data frame using Modin, and PyTorch and TensorFlow is also in the pipeline, as well as we are looking on a distributed execution using Dask as well. Additionally, we are looking at external storage-based operations as well to use disks, as well as using UCX for communication. So in summary, we have presented Cylon, a fast, scalable, distributed in-memory table, and it enables data engineering everywhere and can be used as either a standalone framework or as a library. And it has very trivial overheads when switching between Python or Java language runtimes. So, we believe that the opportunities are endless with Cylon, and Cylon is still in very early stages. So we invite everybody, let us all collaborate. And we would also like to be a part of the Apache community in the long run. So thank you very much. And on behalf of the Cylon team, let me thank everybody who tuned in, and we would be open for questions. If you guys have any questions, please put it on in the chat and we can answer.
We have a question. I understand they are not a distributed portion of Cylon yet. Is it correct? So the operations we have, we can run with MPI underneath in the distributed mode. So use MPI to distribute Cylon to a distributed mode. So that's the distributed mode available.
We would make the presentation available in the ApacheCon drive as well. Let me upload it there. we have 5 more minutes.
Yes, so NPIs, so we have a question after the integration with DAS and Spark, maybe NPI is not necessary. So yes, I think that is true. Like, so we are using NPI at the moment to distribute, like if we can integrate with other frameworks that provides their own communication, we can use those as well. Also, we are trying to implement like this UCX, which is a communication library for our communication. So that will remove the dependency for API as well. So when we use Dask, we can use UCX for communication, for the communication that they provide. So I think the time is almost up.
Yeah. So I uploaded the slide deck into the Apache drive as well. If anybody is interested.
So thanks everyone for joining us into the presentation.
Thank you very much.